The Robbie Vincent Show.
It is a rare opportunity to grab Rod Temton actually sitting down on a seat and talk to one of our hottest ever songwriting exports. We've got him. He is nailed to the floor, tied to the chair. His return ticket has been confiscated. We've banned him from all hotels and we've actually got him here. And it all, in a way, really started with this one. Written, of course, by Rod Temperton, and those were the days when you actually played keyboard, wasn't it, Rod?
That's right.
When you were a real working musician.
Yeah.
And before I talk to Rod Temperton, news coming in, and we're getting reports of an explosion involving a car in South Croxted Road in Dulwich. No more details, more as it comes in from the newsroom. As first reports of an explosion involving a car in South Croxted Road in Dulwich, more details from the newsroom as they come in. Of course, you come back to a very different London town now, don't you? Because why do you live in Germany? Do you just like the country? Because trying to capture you is like trying having a pet dodo. You know, it's unheard of.
Well, it just happens to be nice and peaceful and quiet and enables me to get on with the writing as fast as possible. And unfortunately, I've not been able to be here for about 2 years for any length of time because obviously all the work's been at this point in the States. So it's kind of commuting between the States and West Germany all the time.
Is that where you bumped into Heatwave initially in Germany?
Yeah, Johnny and two of the guys were originally in the military in Germany, and after they left, they came back over and wanted to carry on with the band, and finally met up with me. And from there, we moved out of Germany and started doing other countries, and then finally came to England.
How long had you been working as a band before Boogie Nights actually cracked it? Because you produced an album, did you? Eight and a Half Stepping was the first single, then Boogie Nights. So how long had you been working as a band before you actually got a recording deal and did an album?
I think about 4 years. It was, we did a lot of road work, and, we used to play 5 or 6 hours a night on stage, and so we could really get it all together. And then about 3 years later, we came to England for the first time, and did a demo up in the north, and came down with this demo with three songs, which were Always and Forever, Super Soul Sister, and Another, and went around the record companies and managed to get the job, and got the gig, and went in to make the album.
From there. And you're here doing a new Heatwave album. Why the decision to do a Heatwave album, or the new Heatwave album, in London as opposed to America?
Well, we did two in the States, one in New York and one in LA. And we thought it'd be a really nice idea to come back to home territory where it all started and get the old team back together and hit it again.
And how's it feeling?
Oh, great. I mean, it's a real nice change to be here.
My guest, Rod Temperton. To come, music from Quincy Jones, Michael Jackson, Brothers Johnson, Paddy Austin, George Benson, Bob James.
Good old-fashioned spell. Baby, you and I both know so well.
You've got me dreaming.
Wave, Dreaming You, written by Rod Temperton from their album Candles. You've always had a very special relationship with Johnny Wilder and Heatwave, having known them for all those years, but at what point did you decide that you wanted to concentrate more on production and writing and less playing the keyboards with the band?
Well, I've got to admit, since I was about 22, 23, I always wanted to write. That was the main thing, write and arrange. And when I got together with Johnny, in actual fact, I always told him, listen, in the end, I want to be a writer as my main thing. So he knew that from the top. Of course, with spending 4 years working together on the road, we became a very, very close family. And there's always been that love between us. And it's now nice to be always coming back to do something with the guys again.
So when you decided to stop playing on the road and concentrate on more writing on production, how did you come to meet Quincy Jones?
Well, in actual fact, when I left the band, I didn't have anything going. I just was hoping that something would happen. And then I went to New York to cut Heatwave 3, the Hot Property album. And one night while we were in doing a track, a phone call came through and somebody said, it's Quincy Jones on the phone for you. And I went and I said, hello.
Hello, did you say hello, sir?
Yes, I said, hello, Mr. Jones. And so he asked me if I would be so kind as to try and write something for Michael Jackson and Rufus, who he's doing at the same time. And initially I said, well, I'm sorry, but it's impossible because I'm in the middle of a Heatwave project and it's really difficult for me to, you know, move between two things. I really do hate to be involved in two things at the same time. It's really difficult when you've got your heart in one thing to be swinging them out. But because it was Quincy Jones, he finally got me to agree to do just one tune for each artist. So I said, okay. I said, when is it? He said, oh, next Saturday, you know. Oh, my goodness, yeah.
Where had he spotted your songwriting from, though? Had you sent him some demos of some songs?
He knew the first two Heatwave albums well. Well, the first one. And then on a trip a year and a half earlier to L.A., Johnny and I did actually meet him at his house. And we actually played in the second album. This was just before the second album came out. And we had a talk for an hour or so, and that was it, really. I mean, it was just a nice chat.
And Jumping Rufus and Michael Jackson, of course, you actually ended up writing some stuff for Mr. Jones, sir.
That's right, yeah. It was great, too.
Come on out tonight and we'll pull you up. Ain't no use in dragging your feet.
Basil and Taz, Quincy Jones, written of course by Rod Temperton for Mr. Jones, sir. I mean, it's a long way from having fish and chips in Cleethorpes and having Quincy Jones on the phone, because presumably as you were coming along with Heatwave and getting into music, I suppose you'd be looking at the work of Quincy Jones.
That's right, I used to listen to his records all the time. And obviously, when it actually came up, it was a real thrill. Yeah. And now he rings me up and I'm still eating fish and chips. He always catches me in the middle.
We dedicate that one to Nikki on passing her driving test and tell her she's now the official Prairie Oysters chauffeur. And she can give us free lists. Lots of love from Steph and the Prairie Oysters. It's really dangerous to pass your driving test. You find yourself being elected the chauffeur overnight. Now, from the phone call to do the Michael Jackson album, what happened? Did you write one song, or what did you do?
Well, I went back to the hotel in a real tizzy, you know, because I was working in the studio till about 2 a.m, and then when I got home, I had to then sit down and start to write something for Michael. And as there was no time to meet Michael or Quincy beforehand, I thought to myself, well, the best thing is to try to write at least 3 songs and then present them to him and say, well, you know, fellas, you can take which one you want. So I did that, and it was all kind of written in those hours, you know, between 3 a.m. and 9, because I was back in the studio with Heatwave at 10. And so I went to L.A. that weekend, and a car picked me up, took me straight to the studio, and Quincy grabbed hold of me and threw me in and said, this is Rod, fellas, he'll show you what to do. And we cut the 3 tracks in 2 afternoons, in a Saturday afternoon and Sunday afternoon. And at the end of it, I walked in the studio in the control room and said to Quincy, well, there you go, which one would you like? He said, what are you talking about? He said, oh, we'll take all 3. So I thought, conned again, you know.
Yeah.
from Michael Jackson's album Off the Wall, which sold in absolute bucket loads. Another Rod Temperton song. Do you find you write best under pressure, then? Do you need to be put on the spot by someone like Mr. Jones, sir?
Well, I certainly hope so, because these days it happens all the time. Yeah, I think that when you're under pressure and you know you've got to come up with it, it certainly helps a lot. You know, you can just go straight in and do it.
Yeah. Had you ever seen yourself writing for somebody like Michael Jackson? Were you able, you said you hadn't met him, were you able to see how he would sing and what sort of song would suit him? Or?
Well, I think that's the whole point. The way I like to write is to be able to direct my attention directly at the artist and say, now what do they like and what do they need, and let's try and get it together from that. Rather, it suits me much better, actually, under pressure, because then I've got a direction to go in. I know what I've got to do, and I can do it rather than just sitting at home and writing a song.
OK, you've got a dedication there that somebody specifically asked if you would try and read out in your best Cleethorpes accent.
Yes, it says, "Dear Robbie, in this the autumn and winter season of funk, could you wish Randy Mandy of the Southgate Soul Searchers a very happy birthday and say hi to Phil, Lloyd, Andy, Neil, Lorraine and Nigel from the man with the voulavants, Darren Fogle of Southgate." And he says, "P.S. could you ask Rod Temperton to read this dedication if possible?" Well, I did, Darren, and that's 50p. Please send it to me, care of Utopia Studios.
10 out of 10, he's got the job. And something for the Hanwell Funk Masters, Peveril the Funky Phantom, Phil the Funk Brigadier, Pete the Beat, and the Grandmaster of Rap. Please say hi to Daz Funk, who's been banished. He says, "No hard feelings, Daz. Many funks, Purbro." And Jan wants to wish your brother John a happy 20th birthday. Happy birthday to you. Just because you're a great guy. Isn't that nice? Brothers and sisters still getting on after all these years. George Benson, was that interesting?
Oh, yes. It's always nice to do something with a musician who can really, really play fabulously. And that's George.
Time.
Love Times Love, George Benson. Another Rod Temperton song, my special guest on the Robbie Benson Saturday Show. And that's dedicated very especially for Angela and her two bridesmaids, Susan and Sally. See you at the altar, says Graham Ash, because he's marrying Angela this afternoon at 4 o'clock at St Mary's Church, Wargrave in Berkshire. Best wishes to all relations and friends, and let the funk flow to Farnborough, where we're making our new home. Hope it really goes well for you this afternoon. And before more conversation with Rod Temperton, we've got some more details on that explosion in South Croxted Road in Dulwich. Police still don't know if it's been caused by a bomb. The London Ambulance Service say the incident involves two cars and two people have been taken to King's College Hospital. The fire brigade have released one person from the wreckage of the vehicles before being ordered out of the area by police who fear there may be a further explosion. More details from our newsroom later. Rod, we move on now to two of my favourite characters, the brothers Johnson. And this was, of course, a project that you look forward to because you co-wrote a lot of the songs on the album with them and shared the writing. Did you build up a special relationship with them?
Yeah, definitely. I don't think I've ever met anybody with so much energy as Lewis especially. Well, both of them. But when the first time I met them was at Quincy's house, and Lewis just walked in, never said hello, just said to us all, "Can we show you a movie?" And we said, "Yeah." You know, so he immediately took a cinema projector out of his handbag and put it towards the wall and started this film. And it showed a Christmas tree with a wooden guitar with no strings leaning against it. And on the screen walks Lewis, aged 5, sees this guitar, his eyes light up, he picks it up and starts thrashing it in the way we've all seen him. And it appears this is a guitar that Lewis's dad had made for George for Christmas. So the next thing you see is George, age 5, walk on the screen, see Lewis get terribly angry, take the guitar off him and beat him over the head with it.
Where do they get their energy from? And they bounce off each other all the time, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, I've got no idea. It's just that is them. That's what they're all about. And they're just great guys to work with. Very spontaneous.
Because they are fairly mad in the nicest possible way outside of the studio. But when you get in the studio with them, does the professional discipline return very quickly?
Well, there sure is a professional discipline, but the one thing that it's nice to see is that they always throw everything into it. When they finish the rundown of the first take, they're sweating real, you know, terribly. I mean, it's amazing, you know, just to see that kind of energy coming out.
And did you enjoy, you obviously, it's a silly question to ask, but you obviously enjoyed writing with them.
Oh, yeah, it was a lot of fun. I used to go around to Lewis's house and we'd sit there all day bashing about. It was great fun.
Right, we have a Brothers Johnson track, Light Up the Night, from the album. And after that, the story, which I'm going to try and persuade Rod to tell us, about Quincy Jones, who didn't believe that he kept writing all these songs. He had suspicions. This one's for Graham and Steve and all the Legionnaires. Nice to see you last night. And yes, who knows, the record you asked for might be on the All Winners show next week.
The spark we brought to the table.
Light Up the Night, of course, from the Brothers Johnson album, Light Up the Night. Written by Louis George and Rod Temperton, my guest on the programme this lunchtime. Now, there is a story circulating, Rod, that you kept producing so many songs that Quincy Jones didn't believe that you were writing them, and you casted around some hidden songwriters in a giant suitcase, which used to let them out at night in your hotel room and then put them away in the morning.
Well, all I can say really is he does tend to lock me up when I get there. He kind of locks me in the hotel room and says, "Okay, hit it," you know. I don't know what they think, but I'm always trying.
You know? I mean, it's a good story if you could imagine that you go around with a giant suitcase and these other songwriters hop out and help you during the course of the night, and then when Quincy Jones lets you out, you have all these songs.
That's right, it's the Cleethorpes team. You yeah. know?
Since you've been in London, and I know you come over for a few days at a time, but this is your longest period in London for quite some time,
right,
isn't it?
Right.
What about the music scene over here? It's very much changed, hasn't it, since those early days of Heatwave? Because Heatwave really being a pioneer of the sort of music we're hearing a lot more of now.
Right, well, I mean, obviously, with not being here, it's been difficult for me to keep up with what's happening. So coming here, I get some fresh insight, and groups that I'm sure the listeners and you have known for some months are fresh to me. I mean, actually, in the studio we're working at the moment, Beggar and Company next door, and I heard a couple of tracks from their new thing yesterday, which sounded really good. And it's nice and interesting to see some new ideas coming out of the city.
Do you agree with those who say that at the moment America, and this isn't actually fired at you, of course, that America at the moment just does appear to have gone a little stale, that they're not being particularly imaginative and are going through one of their...
Yeah, I mean, I think R&B goes through phases in the States, and it is definitely time for a new sound to come out. Personally, I thought when Prince first came out with his hot single, that it was going to be a bit of a new direction, and I don't think it's quite carried on from that, but... I'm sure that everybody's looking at the moment, and I'm sure this year will probably bring something new.
Mm. Do you think that, in a way, spells well for the bands working out of London or out of this country, getting into British R&B, because it isn't American R&B, it's British R&B?
Right, it's completely different, and I think at this point there is an opportunity for a band to sneak through and really hit it big in the States.
Have you always been a fan of Patty Austin?
Yeah, well... Before I worked with her, I didn't know her work too well. As soon as I started working with her, I mean, she is one of these people in the industry who is a total laugh a minute and never stops. And her voice is just incredible. So before doing the album with her, she obviously sang on two or three things we'd worked together on, and we became very close friends, and she's incredible.
Sweetness.
Love Me to Death, Paddy Austin. Dedicated to Angela, Hailsham Close Surbiton in Surrey, and of course the hometown is no longer Cleethorpes of Rod Temperton, but now lives in Germany. And Gregory's stationed out there, and Gregory says, looking forward to seeing you around Christmas time, Angela, and sends lots of luck. And the best of luck to Peter and Enzo in their new business venture, Spray and Crash Repairs. And say hi to the old King's Lodge lot as well. This is the right weather for spray and crash repairs. And more on the explosion in South Croxley Road in West Dulwich. One woman has been seriously injured, and police have confirmed that the anti-terrorist squad are on their way to the scene, and they fear there may be another explosion. More details in our news, of course, at 1 o'clock. Now, Rod, you very much talk about a family of friends you gather around you, Quincy and the brothers Johnson, and of course Johnny Wilder, and Greg Fillinganes, who had his album out a few months ago. Now, where does he fit into the picture? Because he pops up on album after album after album.
Yeah, that's right. He originally played with Stevie Wonder's band. In fact, Stevie found him, and then came by way of the Jacksons, I think, through to Quincy. And so he's played on basically all the albums I've worked on with Quincy. And, I mean, he's amazing because he's one of those few people with perfect pitch, and you can play him a tune down and he'll just go in and play it back to you. And on tour in Japan, when we went there this summer, he was just amazing. He would sit on the stage before the show and run through a repertoire of 20 of the latest hits, you know, just like that, straight down.
He was one of the Quincy Jones Orchestra, was he, on this
That's
tour
right.
of Japan?
That's the, right. The keyboard players were Greg and Quincy and me. And then, you know, we took actually 20 guys from L.A. and all the best musicians, and then picked up a symphony orchestra over there and just did 4 concerts. It was amazing.
What sort of things did you play? Did you do orchestral arrangements to the Quincy Jones album?
Yeah, we actually, the first number of the show was Roots, the Roots theme, and we went through all his stuff, through Walking in Space, Smackwater Jack, all that kind of stuff, right up to date, and ended with a medley of my tunes.
What was the reaction in Japan?
Well, I think it's one of the only countries that you can really pull that kind of thing off, because the Japanese audience really like to get in depth into every artist they see. In fact, they know more about me than I do, you know. And so they really like to appreciate everything. And the concerts were 2.5 hours long, and they never stopped, you know. I mean, it was great.
Did it make you want to go back on the road again, or was that just enough?
No, that was just enough. I mean, I haven't played for 4 or 5 years, and that was a real nice change for 4 days, but I don't like to do it all the time.
Greg Fillinganes from his album, part of the Quincy Jones Orchestra in Japan.
Looking back on brighter days of being with you, they were all I had. I wish there were more. You were so kind, you blew my mind. Now love is cold, you're not for me anymore. Seems as though along the way you're acting different. What it is I cannot say. I feel torn apart inside. Our love had life, but now feels dead, and no one knows what lies ahead. Oh, I don't wanna have to be the one to say it's all over, please go away. Don't worry about tomorrow, can't find yesterday.
wasting time. Days linger on, they're like a nightmare in my mind. Trouble on the way, no doubt. Fond memories past are fading fast. Soon I'm afraid time will run out.
Greg Fillinganes from his excellent album, Significant Gains, I Don't Want to Be the One. Dedicated very specially to someone who's got a birthday on the 15th. That was just a couple of days ago. Happy birthday, Renuka. And that comes from the Goose in North London. He says he's done a conversion job. She has now left the Adam and the Ants fold and has joined Goose. After the Heatwave project, I assume you find yourself now being booked up well in advance, do you, with other projects already in the bag to do?
That's right. In fact, the day I finish here in London, I have to fly straight to LA to start Herbie Hancock's new album. And I have a feeling that, I get Quincy on the phone every day. He's doing Donna Summer at the moment, and I know he's going to try and drag me out of the studio there to do a track on that too. And then, of course, next year we start with Michael Jackson on February the 1st for the follow-up to Off the Wall.
When's the new Heatwave album scheduled for release?
I should think that it will be available around February time.
Of next year?
Yeah.
OK, I'll have to do Herbie Hancock, but one question, going back to the George Benson album, why did you present Star of the Story off the second Heatwave album for possible inclusion by George Benson? Did you think it would suit his style?
Well, at the time we were doing the album, I was writing something in the vein of Star of the Story that Quincy heard, that I'd just started to write. And which reminded him of Star of the Story, and said, Star of the Story, that's the track, we should really do that, because it's right up Benson Street. And it's always been my favourite song of all the songs I've ever written. So I was quite pleased.
Break the spell, 'cause you're the star of a story I'll always tell. Angel used to say yesterday love was only in a dream. But angel, I was wrong all along. Just took you to make me see. So hold me all through the night. Stay till the day is bright. And angel, don't ever break the spell, 'cause you're the star of the story I love so well.
The story, George Vincent. I didn't know that was your favourite song.
Yeah, it's always been the one, because I like songs that set up a mood as well as the melody, and that's the nearest I've been able to get to it.
Now, what about the project with Bob James? That was a whole different ball game. Why did you decide to do and say, yes, I will do Bob James?
Well, I had a very successful year last year, as you know, and this year I thought, well, I've really got to do something that is special and interesting to me, and not worry so much about the hit record then. And Bob came to me and asked me to do it, and actually said to me, I don't really want, it doesn't have to be a pop song, because I don't sing a pop single, so I'm an instrumental artist, it's a chance to do something different, and that's what made me take it.
Okay, thanks for joining us on the programme. I know you've got a very, very heavy schedule, and the best of luck with the new Heatwave album. I look forward to the next project, Herbie Hancock, followed by Michael Jackson.
That's right.
And long may you write lots of beautiful songs.
Thank you, mate. Thank you, listeners. And this is a wake-up call for Heatwave.
It's time you were up.
Johnny and friends at the studio beckons. Is that where you're off to now?
That's right. Yeah.
It's a sign of the times, Rob. We've all got to earn a living. Rod Temperton.
Thank you. Change in time.
Bob James, the latest offering from Rod Temperton. Sign of the Times, dedicated to Dopey Dez, Crazy Mark, Simple Simon and Mark Funky Stanley on his birthday, who made it to the Southwest. This is a Robbie Vincent Saturday show on Radio London, 206 medium wave, 94.9 stereo VHF, and from next Saturday, a brand new VHF transmitter, so it should be super, super stereo. It's coming up to news time, and after the news, I'll be back with a track from that brand new Earth, Wind & Fire album. It's 1 o'clock on 206.